Welcome to tonight's Drivers Ed class. Our second week of Drivers Ed. I hope everybody had a great weekend and a great holiday yesterday. Now we're back. Getting all the information needed to receive the driver's license. I see Troy just jumped in. Troy, if you could do me a favor and text me your availability on 973-9118. So make sure that you text me. Let me know when you can drive. You are the only one who has not driven yet. And I'd like to start you so we can get going. Birthday, but I don't want to go too late. I do have openings for tomorrow in the afternoon. So just let me know if anybody would like to drive. And Troy, by the way, texting me is how you check in. So I appreciate the comments here. How about that? Let's turn that right down. I apologize for the music being too loud. There we go. Okay. So, Troy, I'll give you 2 o'clock. 3 o'clock is still open for anybody that wants to drive. I can do that. And then we'll work on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday a little bit later. We almost have a full class. I see that we only have 7 people here in attendance, so we're going to wait till we get everybody. There's 8. We're missing one more. I know the music was really, really loud today. I apologize. I wish there was a number that I could just set it at. It's just a slide. So I'll just get rid of that entirely. I do want to go. Some of you did not do the worksheet that I gave you. The worksheet of cars. So hold on a second. Let me throw this up on the screen. These things. Okay. I'll put both of them up. There we go. Okay. These were what you were supposed to do. Okay. I did not get one from everybody. So remember when I give you work to do, it's really important that you do it so I can actually check it off as you're doing your homework. If not, then there's going to be a delay in completing you through the driver's ed program. And this stuff shouldn't be that complicated. And even if you were to miss, you know, a few questions or a few items, I'm not looking for getting 100%, but I'm looking at your effort and trying to get as much information out to you as possible. Now, if you take a look at these charts, and I am going to get out of these for right now, and I'm going to do this so quick that even if you had to write this down, you probably couldn't do it anyways. But I am going to give you, and for those of you that did do it, the answers. So I'm going to go real quick so you have an idea of what we have here. A is the airbag on and off switch. We have this on trucks because it's really important. We're going to talk about airbags tonight, that when you have a young child over on the passenger side, it is not advisable to have them there. So what you would have to do is take this little knob and turn it to the off position so the airbag would be deactivated. B always comes on. That is your airbag readiness. Remember, a light comes on when you start the vehicle and the computer system checks it and then it turns it off. Remember, yellow is for warning. Red is for items that need our immediate attention. C is for anti-lock brake system. D is theft. E is auxiliary power point, which means a charging point for your iPod or phone. F is battery charging system. G is brake system warning. H is like a check engine, okay? On the driver's ed vehicle, it's basically for, oh, I don't know if you can hear this, but a fire truck's going by right now. I live right near a fire department, so a lot of times we hear the police car and the fire truck go by. I is for climate control, so where the air is being circulated around inside the vehicle. J is your door lock, unlock. K is your oil light. L is your temperature gauge. I do want you to know that, so make a note of that. If you've got a piece of paper or a notepad that you take your notes during driver's ed, just put a little notation. Temperature gauge is really important. It's that my engine is overheating. It's either C or H or a light like this that'll come on. M always comes on. The minute you start a car, this light will come on and then turn off automatically. N is fog lamps. O is four-wheel drive. P is your gas gauge. Q is fuses. And part of the homework that I gave you for know your vehicle, so that still is due. I'm not going to go over that. But I do want you to get out your owner's manual, and I'll cover that as soon as I get through these items here first, and we'll talk a little bit about the car manual. R is your hazard flashers. S is for your wipers. Now, the wiper on an American car, you can see that lever is pointing to the left. That is probably an American vehicle where you spin that knob to activate your windshield wipers. On an import, you're more likely to find the lever pointing to the left. I mean, on the right-hand side of the steering wheel, pointing to the right, and you actually have to manually bring down the lever to activate the wipers. T is your headlights. U is the hood release. V is your horn. W is the ignition switch. X is the dimmer panel light. That's the light that goes over. Y is the lighter. I just broke my mic. Haha. Hold on a second. There we go. Came undone on me. Z is your dash headlight. AA is your overdrive. BB is the parking light. CC is your side view mirrors, which we do have this on the driver's ed vehicle. Double D is your power windows. Double E is your defroster in the back. Double F is speed control. I actually have a lever rather than something that's activated on the steering wheel. Double G is your tilt wheel. And by the way, if you had difficult time finding out some of these, when I first saw that, I had no clue what that looked like. I had no idea double G was the tilt wheel. Double H is your trunk release. Double I, turn signal. Double J, defroster in the front. Double K is your windshield washer. Double L is your wipers. And double M is your electronic traction control, which tells you when you are losing contact with the roadway. So I really wanted you to use your manual. Whoop, wrong thing. Huh, I got rid of everything. Or maybe it, hold on, let's see if I can bring this back. I do not know why I got rid of that. Well, anyways, I wanted you to draw your engine compartment. And notice it says fuse box, and it shows you where your brake fluid reservoir is, your coolant. I really think it's important for all of you. Let me put another one up here. Well, that's on tire size. But your owner's manual gives you so much information about your vehicle. It's more than just learning to drive, because you're driving something that's mechanical and it will break down. It's just a part of nature, is that anything that has moving parts will wear down. And it's important for you to understand that before you have a serious problem, is there any way that I could have dealt with that problem before it ruined the engine or ruined the car? And a lot of times these warning symbols will be activated to allow you to get to help quickly before it becomes a more serious problem. So I'm just trying to acquaint you with your vehicle, what is required, where things are located. You're not going to be a mechanic. Don't get me the wrong way. This is really just for you to know when something's a little bit off. And everybody should know how to put fluid, like gas, oil, windshield washer fluid, power steering fluid, anything that's fluid. Think about it. You're opening a canister on the inside of your engine. You're taking a cap, you're taking it off, and you're filling it to the max level if it's low. And all these little reservoirs will have a minimum level and a maximum level. All you're doing is maintaining and making sure it's where it's supposed to be, between those two levels, preferably near the top. So if you haven't done this sheet, I want it in by the end of this week. And I'll probably have to text some of you that haven't done it. But I would say at least half of you have. So kudos to you. Good job with getting that done. And I think that was probably the end of that PowerPoint. That's why, here's my good camera. So that was knowing your instrument panel and knowing where everything is. So tonight's subject is on seatbelts, airbags, and helmets. Safety equipment in the vehicle is so important. Now, seatbelts is something you manually have to do. And we'll talk about the definitions between passive and active and things like that. But it's very important, I want you to write this down, is that since you are the driver of the vehicle, once you get your license, you are responsible for everybody inside the car. So you are legally responsible and financially responsible for everybody inside the vehicle. So what we're going to try to do is focus on how effective are these items in a car? How do they actually work? When will they not work? So we're going to be taking a look at behavior and attitudes. And if you take a look at what your homework for tonight is, all I've got written down is project. So your homework for tonight is going to be a safety item project. So something on the car, whether it be a seatbelt, an airbag, or a helmet, you're going to have to do either a poster, you're going to have to do a radio ad, or a video dealing with why is it important to be in your seatbelt? Why is it important to buy a car that has multiple airbags, and how do airbags work? Or why is it important on a scooter or a motorcycle to have a helmet on? So I'm going to give you the information. I want you to write down some important facts, and I want you to put that into your project, okay? And we'll talk more about what that project's going to look like at the very end of tonight. So let's take a look at some of the facts hanging around seatbelts, airbags, and helmets. What is the real story, okay? What are the facts? Now, you would think that car seats and seatbelts have been around since we've had moving vehicles, and that's not always the case. It really wasn't until the 70s that seatbelts really started to be more prevalent. Even though we had them slightly before then, it wasn't something that people actually put on unless they thought they were a bad driver or they thought they were going on a long trip. A lot of times if you were going down to the neighborhood store to pick up some milk and eggs or to drive your kids to school, you just threw them in the back seat. I would almost venture to bet that if you spoke to your parents or your grandparents that they did not wear seatbelts back in the 60s and 70s. But look at what they do now. Do your parents wear their seatbelt? Do your grandparents wear their seatbelt? So what made them change? Was it just because we made it a law, or did they have a change of attitude? And that's what we want to work on right now, because in New Hampshire, the only law that we have is under the age of 18, you need to be in a seatbelt. Once you're over the age of 18, it's totally up to you. And it's not that case in every state. And we're going to talk about, well, how do you know and what should you do? But look how safety has changed. If you take a look at that baby sitting in the front seat, that little tiny strap is not going to keep her from hitting that metal bar. And that metal bar doesn't look like it's padded. It doesn't look like it's too safe. But in our mind, okay, in our mind, we think that was a safety device. Okay, far from it. Okay, I would almost venture to bet that your grandparents will even admit to holding a young child like this while the car was moving. Can you imagine stepping on the brakes real quickly or being involved in a frontal crash, holding a baby? That baby becomes like your airbag. That baby will actually take the brunt of the force of you hitting the steering wheel or the dash. I mean, think of this. How many people have you seen driving around with their dog in the on their lap in the front seat? I mean, that's not too safe either. Just because one, because the dog or the cat, any animal, may see another animal and get a little bit aroused, you know, and start to growl and move around. Okay, and that's going to be hard to control the vehicle if you've got an animal in the front seat with you. So who's least likely to wear a seatbelt? What we have found, and write this down, young adults, 18 to 24. So just as you get out of when it's required, that's when people are going to start not wearing it. Men are more likely not to wear them than women. Women seem to be a little bit more responsible. People that live in the city, are more likely to wear a seatbelt. Those in non-metropolitan areas are less likely. State laws, state seatbelt use are in the lower states with secondary enforcement of seatbelt laws or no seatbelt laws, 86% in 2017 compared to states with primary enforcement. So I want you to write down, I think this is the next slide. And people in the back too, write this down. People in the back are less likely to wear a seatbelt. People in the front seat are more likely to wear a seatbelt. But I just mentioned primary and secondary. Oh, this is a graph from almost 10 years ago. I'm trying to get more up-to-date information. This is the latest information that I could get. But if you take a look at New Hampshire, we have the lowest percentage rate of seatbelt use. Most every state around us, except for Massachusetts, is kind of tied with us. So we're really low. We want to get to that dark, dark, bluish color. Those are the states. And I would almost venture to guess that they have mandatory seatbelt laws and their primary offenses. So what do I mean by primary and secondary? So this is what I want you to write down, because this is going to help you when you go from state to state. Most states do have seatbelt laws. Some are considered primary, some are considered secondary. The states that you have to be worried about are those that are primary. So a primary traffic violation, for example, speeding, failing to stop at a red light or have your seatbelt on, is that the officer sees you do any of these offenses, he can write you up a ticket. So he sees you not doing something, you get a ticket. Now, a secondary traffic law means something else has to have taken place. So they can't pull you over for not having your seatbelt on. So if you roll through a red light or a stop sign, they're pulling you over for that. But if they notice that you don't have your seatbelt on, then it becomes a ticket. So it becomes the second ticket, or what we call a secondary traffic law. It says how down the bottom, though, however, some types of secondary offenses can be primary offenses in certain situations. For example, in some states, whether a seatbelt violation is primary or secondary depends on the age. So here in New Hampshire, the age is 18. So, you know, if you are older in some of these states, then it would be a secondary. But if it's a minor, then it does become a primary. What we have found out that seatbelts do save lives. That is a fact. That is a true statement. What they recognize is of about all the crashes that take place every year, around 15,000 or slightly more, okay, will normally be saved because of seatbelts. And that's a pretty consistent, here it says in 2016. But year in, year out, we find that number to be pretty much the same, pretty close. And it does help you with not having real bad injuries. So no one wants to, and I used to do this in class, and it was kind of a funny thing until somebody got hurt. If a lot of people say, well, if I'm in a parking lot, do I really need a seatbelt on? And I ask people, well, how fast do you travel in a parking lot? Most people drive a car probably between 10 and 15 miles per hour in a parking lot looking for a parking space. So I've told students, what do you think it feels like if you were to run up and run as fast as you can into that wall? It's usually a cement wall in a school. And most of them said, well, it probably isn't that bad. I could probably run, you know, and hit a wall and it wouldn't hurt. It hurts, okay? And most people will tend to turn their shoulder when they hit the wall or put their arms out. What's your first reaction when you're going to get hit by a car? You put your arms out if you're a passenger. It's just a natural reaction, okay? Your arms are not going to brace you with the instrument panel. You're still going to feel the brunt of the force, or your elbows are going to get shoved right back into your chest. It's going to be pretty violent. And we're going to see this in a couple of videos about how bad the impact at most crashes. Most crashes happen at speeds of around between 30 and 40, 45 miles per hour. Now, do they happen at higher speeds? Yes. But most real bad crashes are going to probably be right around 40, 45 miles per hour, where people are on these what we call secondary roads, which aren't quite highways, but they're really not like neighborhoods. You got some traffic lights. 108, 155, where we travel a lot in the driver's ed car, would probably be classified as one of these streets. So you get hit on that road, it's going to be pretty violent. What we're trying to do is, and we did this back in the 80s, and we've done a pretty good job of it now over 40 years, is that attitudes have changed about seatbelt use. And it's only because of educators, because of nurses and doctors letting people know. And by the way, and you can write this down, if your insurance company knows that your car is equipped with different type of safety devices, like additional airbags, it has certain type of crumple zones or some type of reinforced A-pillars. And that's what an A-pillar is, right between your side window and your front window. That little tiny window near your vents up front, that's what we call the A-pillar. You know, if we find cars built a certain way, we're going to reward you on your insurance rates, because we know that your car is protecting you, so the insurance company isn't going to have to pay out a lot more on injuries and death claims. So if you use these safety devices and your car is equipped with these safety devices, it's going to save you money on insurance, and that's important to know. Parents are getting on board. We saw this with Andy Pilgrim. We tend to mimic what our parents do, so if your parents are wearing safety belts, then I think there's a good chance that you're going to be wearing yours too. And the law is not only for under the age of 18, but it gets very restrictive on young kids, like the ages of 4, 6, 7, you know, how you graduate out of your infant seat to a booster seat, and how you use your harnesses that will help people and save people in event of a crash. So how does New Hampshire stack up? I do want you to write some of this down so you can use this in your poster or your radio ad or your video. The number of deaths, 919. And this is for, I believe, 2016. We're still So number of deaths between 2003 and 2012. I thought that was kind of high for just 1 year, 919. But we are much, much lower in our deaths than the national average. And we find that males, okay, a lot higher. So 7.3 males per 100,000 population 2012 and 2.8 for females. And in New Hampshire, 69% percentage of drivers and front seat passengers wearing seatbelts, but the national average is much higher, is at 86. So I like those two numbers. 86 is what the national. So we've got to step up our game. We're only at 69, and we're hovering around there. I think at one point we got up to around 72, but I don't think we ever got any higher than that. I think our motto on our license plate, live free or die, you know, takes care of our mentality. We are looking at passing new legislation. I just found this, I believe last year I found it, so it's been in my PowerPoint now for a year. But we are looking at making it a mandatory offense in New Hampshire primary to make it mandatory for adults. But whether it passes or not, I'm not too sure if it will. This was about a year ago, so I imagine it's still working its way through legislation. And here it's also looking at rear seat passengers to wear restraints. Down at the bottom, it says they're looking at fines of $50, $25 for adult passengers not wearing seatbelts. So $50 for the driver, $25 for the passenger. And this, I believe, and I've got to get some clarification on this, wonder if there is a law where it's $50 for the driver, $25 for the passenger. Does the passenger pay the fine, or is that added on to the driver's ticket? Meaning that if you're the driver and you've got three passengers and they're going to get fined $25 a piece, that's another $75. That's $75. Do you have to pay that as the driver in additional to your fine, or do the passengers? And I'm not quite sure about what that clarification is, so I'm going to get that figured out. But it could be the driver, because you're the one responsible for everybody in the car. So you're looking at $125 for people not being in their seatbelt, as with a driver with three non-belted drivers, passengers. I want to show you a video now, and it's a little bit lengthy. I think it's about 13 minutes long. It's called Physics Meets Biology. I want to kind of basically show you what happens in a crash. And there are three types of, let's see if this comes up. I think it comes up a little bit later, but I'm going to show it right now. I want you to write down in your notes, there are three types of crashes. All right, so in the video, and I may even stop the video when it gets to it so you can write it down. So write down, in the first collision, something is hitting something else. So it's blank to blank, all right? The second collision will be blank to blank, and then third blank to blank. So there are three things that are happening inside your vehicle with every single crash. And we'll talk about each one in a moment, but I wanted to show you this video.
Why is it that some spectacular race car crashes produce only minor injuries? How can three collisions occur in this one crash between a car and a wall? Answers are determined by the laws of nature and can best be explained when physics meets biology. Through injury biomechanics, the study of the effects of forces on the human body, we've learned much about what happens in high-speed race car crashes, and doctors and engineers have used this information to build safer race cars and tracks. In a similar way, the study of injury biomechanics and crash testing has helped us learn what happens to the human body in passenger car crashes, and what works and doesn't work to reduce injuries and deaths in real-world crashes.
Hi, I'm Griff Jones. I'm a science teacher, and I'm here at the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety's Vehicle Research Center to explore the basic science behind injuries and vehicle crashes. So let's go behind the scenes and take a closer look at what happens to the human body in a crash. What is the first scientific discipline that comes to mind when you think of car crashes? It's probably physics, right? Because Newton's laws of motion govern what happens to a vehicle in a crash. But if we want to understand how crashes cause injuries to people, we need to look at what occurs when physical forces are applied to organs, tissues, and cells. This happens when physics meets biology in a field called injury biomechanics. The Institute's Vehicle Research Center is a world-class facility for vehicle research and testing. A reporter described the crash hall with its three runways as a cross between a Hollywood soundstage and a NASA cleanroom. Vehicles are propelled down the runways at precise speeds, using a system of nitrogen-powered hydraulic motors and cables. The lighting array provides up to 750,000 watts of non-glare illumination for the 500 frames per second high-speed cameras. The research tests they're conducting here today focuses on how injuries occur in real-world crashes. This experimental crash replicates one in which a car hit a tree. In an attempt to understand injury patterns found in the occupants of the actual crash, researchers have disconnected the airbags.
Looking at the driver's chest, we can see the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters of compression. The chest accelerations 70 to 80 G resultant acceleration range. High likelihood of skull fracture.
Very bad.
Yeah, very bad.
Figuring out what just happened in this test crash is the job of the research engineers here. Using sophisticated tools like instrumented crash test dummies, instrumentation in the car, and slow motion film, they can analyze every detail and construct a precise picture of exactly what the vehicle and the occupants went through.
When research engineers use terms like the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters, how does that relate to what a human occupant would experience? If chest acceleration is 70 to 80 G's, which means that a force equivalent to 70 to 80 times the weight of the dummy's chest is pressing on it, is that survivable? How do these guys know the answers?
The search for the limits of human tolerance to forces began decades ago. Today's race car and passenger car drivers benefit from biomechanics studies that were conducted during the 1940s, 50s, and 60s in the field of aviation, investigating how to protect pilots and astronauts from the strenuous forces of ejections and high-speed travel. Colonel John Stapp, a medical doctor and biophysicist in the United States Air Force, used himself as the test subject in his investigations of human tolerance to high-G environments.
From the outside, watch the breakneck stop.
In one of his many tests, Dr. Stapp reached a speed of 632 miles per hour before one of the most powerful braking systems of all time stopped him in 1.4 seconds, subjecting him to more than 40 times the pull of gravity, or 40 Gs. His research helped establish the limits of human tolerance to high G environments and saved many lives through development and improvement of protective systems for ejection seats. Realizing the Air Force lost nearly as many men to car crashes as they did to plane crashes, Dr. Stapp began a car crash program using the rocket sled for seatbelt experiments. Human volunteers working with his biophysics research team endured as many as 28 Gs during safety belt tests. This early research laid the foundation for the complex crash analysis that is conducted here today.
These dummies are a perfect example of combining science, technology, engineering, and mathematics to produce new tools that extend scientific understanding. They are the modern-day version of Dr. Stapp's volunteers. There's not just one dummy for VRC testing, nor even one type. There's a whole family of dummies for crash testing.
This is our crash test dummy family, ranging from a six-month-old all the way up to a 95th percentile male.
95th percentile of what?
That means that it is larger than 95% of the male population in the U.S.
Wow, so this is a big guy.
Yes, if he could stand, he would be about 6'2", about 223 pounds, pretty big. The female, if she could stand, about 5 foot tall, 107 pounds.
How about the smaller dummies?
They're called crabbies.
Grammys. Are they moody?
They're not moody, but it stands for child restraint airbag interaction.
And so when we're doing the frontal crash test, it's 50th percentile?
Yes.
Okay. Side impact is the small female.
Side impact dummy is a very complicated dummy. It has the most instrumentation. They have sensors from the head to the toe. The accelerometers give us the acceleration of the mass. The load cell measures force. And then we have the potentiometers that measure the displacement the ribs actually move.
So dummies are very sophisticated. They provide data from many different body regions. But how do we connect this to people? What is the link between all these crash test data and the injuries that people experience in real-world crashes?
The dummy's measuring different things. It's measuring acceleration, force, and in some cases, distortion of the body parts. Those measurements can be compared against similar measurements made in experiments on biological tissues, using either animal models or cadaver models to get an idea of how much stress can this body part take before it breaks. So in order to understand whether or not a person would be injured, you need to know how strong the bones are, how strong the tissues are, and what conditions will cause them to break.
So the crash test dummies try to get a clearer picture of what's really happening to the people. Is that where the term biofidelity comes from?
It's exactly where the term biofidelity comes from. What biofidelity means is the characteristic of the dummy that represents how close to actually being a human being it is. So the higher the biofidelity, the more like a human being it is in representing how it moves, what types of stresses it measures in the crash test, and then the true to likeness of those measurements to the prediction of injury in a real person.
This is how research engineers can tell us with precision what a human occupant would have experienced in a test crash. Dr. Stapp's experiments, plus years of research with real biological tissues from cadavers and animals, have produced a set of reference values against which we can compare the stresses and strains the dummies experience. So, we can measure these in a test crash and can figure out if they would cause injury to a human occupant. But what do these stresses and strains actually do to people to cause injury? Let's start with some basic anatomy. Your body contains over 100 trillion cells and is structurally organized into four levels: cells, tissues, organs, and organ systems. Tissue is a group of similar cells working together to perform a common function. Organs are made up of two or more types of tissue working together to perform a specific function. And each organ is part of at least one organ system that performs major activities or processes. Your body contains four fluid-filled spaces called body cavities that house and protect your major internal organs. Within the body cavities, your organs are suspended in fluid that supports their weight and prevents them from being deformed by normal movements. Your organs are also protected by your bones and muscles. For example, your heart and lungs are protected by your rib cage and sternum inside the thoracic cavity. Your brain is encased within your cranial cavity and is protected by your skull. Now, with this as background, remember the question from the beginning of this film. How is it possible to have three collisions in a single crash?
Okay, here comes your answer.
Remember, the laws of physics hold true everywhere, on a highway, on a racetrack, and even inside your body. If a race car is going 200 miles per hour, so is the driver's body and every organ inside it. Let's answer the question.
Okay, here we go.
The first collision is between the car and the wall. The second is between the driver and the car's interior. And the third is between the driver's internal organs and the inside walls of his or her body cavities. Tell me a little bit more.
Okay, what I want you to do is to text me what are the three collisions right now. So on your phone, that way I know that you're watching the video and you're paying attention, you've got to text me what are the three collisions. I'm going to just play the video just a little bit longer because they repeat it one more time.
To help us understand more about what happens to organs in the third collision, let's meet Dr. Stephen Olvey, a neurocritical care physician and director of the Neuroscience Intensive Care Unit at the University of Miami's Jackson Memorial Hospital.
Basically, during a crash, you have three collisions. You have the initial crash of the vehicle.
Then you have the occupant hitting something inside the car and coming to a sudden stop.
This results in impacts inside the body. For example, the lungs can hit the inside of the rib cage, the heart can hit the breastbone or inside of the rib cage, resulting in either pulmonary contusion or myocardial contusion. This is what causes ruptured spleens, lacerated livers, because you have part of the organ well anchored and the other part is free to move about. And this causes a shearing force to take place in the organ, resulting in hemorrhage or tearing of the tissue. The brain is...
Okay, so here's your chance. You got to write down what were the three collisions. And we're going to break down, there's only another like 3 minutes left of the video. Then we're going to break down, how does that influence how I perceive my driving? I think it's going to change the way that you look at being safe in a vehicle. Because I think you need to understand is that we don't have as much control over what is happening in a crash after the initial contact. So we'll take a look at it in a moment. But remember, write down, what are the three collisions?
Enclosed in a rigid case, the skull, and it's cushioned and surrounded by the cerebral spinal fluid. The cerebral spinal fluid is actually a different density than the brain itself. So in the event of an impact to the skull, the brain begins to move, the cerebral spinal fluid begins to move, but it moves at a different rate than the brain. So it will actually displace the brains in the opposite direction of the initial impact to the brain.
This simple experiment helps illustrate the phenomenon. This represents your skull. There's water inside representing your cerebral spinal fluid, and the red gel is your brain. The gel floats because it's less dense than water, just like your brain is less dense than your cerebral spinal fluid. What do you think will happen to the brain during impact? Will it move forward, backward, or stay in the same spot? Let's see. The initial movement of the brain is toward the back of the skull. The more dense cerebral spinal fluid moves toward the side of the skull impact, displacing the brain in the opposite direction. If the impact is strong enough, the brain will initially impact the back wall of the skull, then rebound and hit the front of the skull. This type of injury is called the coup contre coup, which is a French term meaning blow against blow. The order of events inside the skull is still debated in the medical community. Whether the more dense fluid displaces the brain in the opposite direction first, or whether the brain moves in the direction of the initial impact first and then is displaced by a wave of spinal fluid, is not yet fully understood. By the way, this simple experiment was designed by a high school student for her science fair project. It was later published in a medical journal and has contributed to the debate. Crash injuries occur when stress develops in tissue. Another way this happens is when one part of the tissue or organ is firmly attached to the torso and another part is free to move. For example, with the heart and its blood vessels, the ascending aorta and its arch are mobile, while the descending aorta is fixed. Here's a demonstration of how a sudden stop, like a third collision, can cause an acceleration injury to the aorta. The aortic arch is represented by the unsupported gel. The gel inside the tube represents the descending aorta, which is fixed to the body. Try to predict what will happen during the collision. The unsupported section of gel continues forward and tears away from the supported gel. During an actual collision, the fixed descending aorta will decelerate along with the body, while the arch and ascending aorta's momentum keep them moving forward. This difference in acceleration or deceleration causes a tear where the fixed and mobile parts meet. Even the inertia of a blood-filled heart can cause stress and strain on the aortic arch. We've been talking about stress and strain on tissues and organs, and we've seen how a crash applies some of these forces. But what is stress and strain in this context? Stress is a measure of the average deforming force exerted over a defined area of tissue. Stress produces strain, which is a measure of how much the tissue deforms as a result of the stress. This special gel has elastic properties similar to certain human tissue, but not all human tissue is of equal strength. Forces and pressures on the outside of your body cause stress within your tissue. Three basic types of stress are tensile stress from stretching, shearing stress from opposing forces, and compressive.
Now, they talked about three different types of collisions. So let's see if I can put this up here on the board. I haven't typed this up before. So let's try to do the first one. So the first one Let me see if I can put this up here. Car to wall. Okay, so write that down. Or it could be car to car. It could be car to object. So make sure you write that down. That's the first collision. The next collision would be, see if I can type this. Would be your body to the inside of the car. That's where you're hitting the dashboard. That's where you're hitting the steering column. And your final collision would be the organs of your body to the inside wall of your body, so body cavity. So what I want you to write down with these three collisions, okay, so this is where I want you to kind of think about this. How much control do you have over a car hitting a wall? Do you have a lot of control, some control, or no control? Okay, think about it. How much control do you have over your vehicle hitting a wall or another car? I think maybe your parents have gone years and years and years without having a collision. Why is that? Because they're a good driver. Because they're paying attention to other people making mistakes out on the road. So if someone's coming towards them, they get out of the way. So in your notes, you have a lot of control over the first collision. That is the only thing that you have complete control over. You can accelerate, you can brake, you can steer. This is why so much emphasis is being put on driver's ed and teaching you how to drive well. It's because we don't want you to be involved in a collision. Now, in your lifetime, will you ever be hit by another car? And I have been hit by, in the driver's ed vehicle, twice. Okay, no serious injuries. We are all in our seat belts and everything. And once I hit black ice and we hit a tree. I wasn't with a student. I was all by myself. So I've hit a tree going around 30, 35 miles per hour. It wasn't fun. But my body did not hit the inside of my car because I had my seatbelt on. And actually it was my truck, and I didn't have an airbag. So luckily my seatbelt was on, because if I didn't have my seatbelt on, I don't know if I would be here. So I want you to write down body to the inside of the car. You have some control. The some control is you have a choice. Even in the states where it's mandatory that you wear your seatbelt, you still could do it illegally. You can look at some states where it's mandatory to have your seatbelt on, and people look around. They're not in their seatbelt because they don't think the cops want to take the time to pull them over and write them out a ticket. They take their chances. So just because it's a law doesn't mean people are going to do it. There are a lot of people that are law-abiding citizens, and they're going to do whatever the state tells them to do. And I think that's a good thing. It's kind of like the people that are refusing to wear masks. Okay. I think the whole mask debate and the seatbelt debate is about the same. People do not want to be told what to do. They don't think it's that big of a deal. Until you catch COVID, okay, because you don't have your mask on inside a restaurant. You don't think seatbelts are that important until you get in a car crash and you spend a week in a hospital recovering from your injuries. So you do have some control over hitting the inside of your vehicle. Now, the last statement here, your organs hitting the inside wall of your body cavity, you have no control over that. None. That's biology. That's how you were built. That's how your genes are. You can see that in a crash, you are losing control. And the part of the video that I liked, I wanted to make sure that you at least saw a little bit about the body moving inside. Concussions are very common. It's because of the brain moving inside, okay, your skull. Okay, it's a real thing. Even if you've got your seatbelt on, you can still get a concussion. But the thing that I came across as being interesting is how the heart in a crash is still moving forward, and it could rip. The aorta can rip, and that's where internal bleeding can happen. So if you're involved in a serious crash, now I'm talking about going 45, 50, 55 miles per hour, and you don't have your seatbelt on, and you hit the dash, you still may be talking, you still may be lucid, but there could be things going on inside your head and inside your body that you won't know about for the next 10, 15 minutes. Then all of a sudden, the shock and the trauma. Now, remember, they talked about stress and strain. That's what we don't want in a vehicle. We don't want that pulling, that torquing of all our organs, because it will do damage. And this is why I want you to write this down. It is so important to go see a doctor, okay, once you're involved in a crash, because it can be hours after the crash and things are going to start taking place, okay? It could be a small leak, a small tear, and it just gets inflamed. So go see the doctor. That's so, so important. So let me X out of that. Most of you did reply. Remember, when I ask you a question, I do want you to text me what the answer is. Now, another reason why you want to wear your seatbelt is that it protects you inside the car. Now, we were just seeing that video where we were talking about the three collisions. Well, what happens if your door opens up or you get thrown through an open window? Okay, what is going to happen? So I've got a quick little clip here of someone being thrown from a vehicle. So watch this. It doesn't happen. So here's a person driving down an empty highway. Look at everything in front of him is empty. He's got one car passing him now. Now watch as he goes underneath. A car crosses over, and that's a person up in the air. That is a person that was just thrown from the vehicle. So he was driving fine. People in front of him were driving fine, but it was over there in traffic where the problem came, and a person got thrown from the vehicle. Let me show it to you one more time. Okay, watch it one more time. I believe it's a car just underneath the underpass that gets hit. See? And that's a person. Probably didn't have his door locked, didn't have a seatbelt on. Look at all the debris on the road. And some of the stuff you just can't avoid. It happens so quick. I do want you to write down this, because most people think if you're in a seatbelt, your body doesn't move. That's fake. That's false. Just because you're in a seatbelt does not mean there's no movement of your body. It means that it will be restricted. Depending on your weight and how close you are to the steering wheel, your body's going to move forward. So this is based on data for a male about 150, 180 pounds. So the head goes 1.9 feet in a 30-mile-an-hour crash. The chest goes 1.3 feet, and the pelvis goes 1.2. And that's where the lap belt is located. Now remember, when you put your seatbelt on, you want it to be snug, meaning that once you put it on, you should pull it to make sure that it's tight across where you wear your belt, okay, your hip. Shouldn't be up near your belly button. Shouldn't be down too low. If you have a heavy coat or a sweater, that's going to create some looseness to your seatbelt. So your body is going to even go a further distance than what's listed right here. So maybe in the wintertime, take off your coat if you're going long distances, so you have the full benefit of the seatbelt. And don't put the shoulder harness behind you. That used to be a pretty popular thing when people were younger. And this is what an airbag looks like. And what we're finding now with automobiles, especially if you've got an SUV, is that no longer is it just the driver. The first airbags that came out were just for the driver. Then we added them for the passenger. And we forgot about the people in the back. And we forgot about side impacts. So as we have gotten more technology, And we have found places and ways to put airbags in small areas, but yet to blow up in the event of a crash to protect you. We have airbags now on SUVs that are on the ceiling in case of a rollover. We have airbags down near your feet on a side crash. We have airbags in the back seat now on some cars. So we are getting more safety-minded. So let's take a look at, and this is just a diagram of the basic components to an airbag. It has to have a sensor. And this is what I want you to write down, because I will test you on this for the midterm. So write this down. Airbags deploy at speeds of 15 miles per hour and faster. If you're going slower than 15 miles per hour, the airbags aren't going to come out. You really probably don't need an airbag at that low speed, and that's probably parking lot speed. Because think about it, if you were to bump a car at 7 miles per hour, just because your foot slipped and you went through your parking space and you went to the vehicle that's directly in front of you, I mean, to replace the airbag, it's going to cost you over $1,000. So we don't want that to happen. So let's take a look at a video of airbags and how they're helping.
Not only does it ruin your day, but it can leave you with serious injuries, or much worse. A proliferation of people refusing to wear seatbelts in the United States back in the 70s led to car makers designing better safety systems to stop natural selection from wiping out a population. And they were called airbags.
Today, airbags are one of the most common safety features you'll find in a new car. But how exactly do they work?
In simple terms, airbags are tightly packed nylon bags, designed to inflate within milliseconds of an impact occurring, stopping your head and body from hitting points around the vehicle like the steering wheel, windows, or other hard points, which can cause serious damage.
Sensors around the vehicle are able to detect an impact force, like another vehicle hitting yours, sending an electronic message to deploy whichever airbags are needed to protect occupants. The car is able to work out whether the impact is significant enough, as the force of the airbag deploying may do more harm than good in a low-speed accident. While early airbags were designed purely to protect the driver, most new cars have an array of airbags spread around the cabin to protect every occupant.
The Santa Fe we have here has 6 airbags, one in the steering wheel, one in the passenger side dash, one in either of the front seats, and curtain airbags that cover all 3 rows.
Again, because airbags deploy with significant force, you can do yourself serious damage if your arms get in the way or if you're simply sitting too close.
Once upon a time, the correct way to hold the steering wheel was at a 10 and 2 position. But driving instructors now say the best position is a 9 and 3, so the airbags have enough room to deploy without causing serious damage by having your arms in the way.
But there's more to occupant safety than just airbags. Cyclist and pedestrian detection systems are another important safety feature that you'll hear more about in the future. In the Santa Fe, it's called Side Exit Assist. If an occupant attempts to open the door while vehicles, cyclists, or in our case, someone on a skateboard is close by, the system will sound an alarm and in some cases prevent the door from being unlocked. The system also reminds the driver to check surroundings are safe before unlocking passenger doors. If you do open the door while a hazard is detected, you'll get this warning. Finally, we have child presence detection systems. So far, Hyundai is the first car maker to introduce the tech, reminding drivers to check the rear seats before exiting the vehicle. It's called Rear Occupant Alert. The system uses sensors in the ceiling to detect movement after the vehicle has been locked. It stays active for 24 hours and will sound the car's alarm if it thinks you've left someone behind. If you've installed Hyundai's AutoLink app on your smartphone, you'll also receive a text if you haven't tended to the car alarm. Just as airbags can save you in the case of an accident, car makers are constantly developing tech like Side Exit Assist and Re-Occupant Alert to prevent accidents happening in the first place.
Now, how cool is that? Not only did they talk about airbags, but they talked about traffic that's coming up on the side when you open up your door. And then if you left a passenger inside your vehicle like a young child, now, who would ever do something like that? That's kind of irresponsible. But now we have apps that are alerting us that we have something still in our vehicle. So the safety devices on our vehicles are so high tech now that I also want you to remember that technology does break down. So this all sounds good. Now, the airbag's pretty foolproof because it's been like 50 years since we've had airbags. It just hasn't been until the last 20, 30 years that we've made it mandatory in vehicles. But some of this technology about the app, about letting someone know that you're in the vehicle, well, wonder if your phone, you know, dies. Wonder if you didn't update your app or whatever. So there could be some glitches if you just rely on that. So there's no excuse for checking before you get outside of your vehicle, making sure everybody has left the vehicle, making sure you look in your mirror over your shoulder before you open your door in case there's a bicyclist or a skateboarder or a vehicle. So it's great to have technology, but you still want to have common sense and know how to take care of some of these situations. I want you to write down the two terms, passive and active. So when we talk about safety equipment, passive means you don't have to do anything. So passive means they're automatic. So airbags would be automatic. Automatic seatbelts, which I don't see them in cars that often anymore. They used to have like a shoulder harness that used to come across on like a little curtain mechanism to close. When you open the door, it was still kind of attached to the car. It was kind of weird, so they've done away with that. Active means manually you have to do it. That means clicking the seatbelt latch for a lap belt, for a shoulder harness, a combination. Some cars that are high performance may have a three-point harness on the vehicle. And then, of course, child restraints. Now, I don't know how many of you have younger brothers or sisters that are still required to be in seatbelts. But as you get older and get a license, maybe babysitting will be in your future, and it will be important for you to know what to do if you have to bring young children to the park or to swimming lessons or something like that. So child restraints are very important, and there are different stages, and we'll talk about that in a moment. Airbags, let's talk about airbags. Only effective if you've got your seatbelt on, and I'll get out of this for a second. And I think I've told you, some of you in the car, is that when you're steering, you're holding on to the steering wheel. So when you make a fast turn, you can hold the steering wheel and your body's not going to move that much. But a passenger that is next to you and you're driving too fast around the corner, that passenger is not holding on to anything. So their body is moving from side to side. So the airbag may not be coming out at them in a square manner. Now you want the airbag coming out to protect your body cavity. So you want to be holding the steering wheel and you want to be at a good distance from the steering wheel to get the benefit of the airbag. So in your notes, I want you to write down, you should stay back, and this is the fourth bullet. The driver should adjust the seat so they're at least a minimum of 10 inches between the steering wheel and their chest. Now, I always tell people, just remember a foot. If you're a foot away from the seatbelt, at least that, you're going to probably benefit from the airbag. If you're too close, there's going to probably be some facial bruising. If you got glasses, it could break your glasses. So being way too close is not good, just as being too far away is not beneficial. So if you could barely reach the steering wheel, maybe the airbag's not going to even reach your chest when it gets to be deployed. In New Hampshire, under 12, you have to be in some type of a seatbelt in the back. Yeah, you don't want them in the passenger area. If you're too short in stature, they talk about a wedge-shaped cushion. This basically, for a driver, sits you up so you get the benefit of the airbag. But I don't think anybody falls into that category. So let's take a look at, how many of you have, write down on YouTube here, so this, you don't have to text me, but I want to see how many people have actually ridden in the passenger side of a vehicle with your feet on the dash like that? How many people have been in a car like that? Let's see how many people will admit to keeping their feet in that position because it probably seems comfortable. You know, it doesn't look that bad. I've actually seen people put their feet out the window. That's crazy. That's not going to be very helpful if you get involved in a crash. So your feet are going to go right, or your knees go right through your eye socket. Here's a picture of a girl that actually had her feet on the dash. Look at that forehead. And I believe that's the way her head is now formed. There's not much more they can do for her. She's undergone some surgeries, but I think that's probably the best situation that she's in. We talked about keeping our seatbelt where it should be. The only thing that I want to mention down at the very bottom, because we haven't talked about headrest, and I believe I've got it on another slide here, but it's called ramping. So write down ramping, R-A-M-P-I-N-G, ramping. Ramping is when your head goes over the headrest. So let me get back to me. I'm sitting in my computer chair, and I have no high rest on my computer chair. So if I'm driving a car and my headrest isn't meeting the back of my head, watch what happens to my head right here. Watch what happens to my head. Do you see how my neck snaps back? So if you're really tall, and we don't have anybody in this class that's extremely tall, but ramping is when your head overextends over your seat. And if you do this with me right now, do this with me. Move your chin and feel these muscles, these muscles right here. These muscles from your chin to your collarbone get ripped away from the bone. The muscles get ripped away from the bone when your head snaps back like this. They all get torn. That is what happens in whiplash, is your head whips back, it gets torqued, it gets twisted. In a violent crash, you could probably break vertebrae. And this is why in some crashes where people die instantly, because it severs the spinal column. But that's for extremely tall people or people that have taken, I don't know why you would do this, but why you would take the headrest off, but you should never do that. But that's what ramping is called, when the head goes over kids should be at least 40 inches tall if they're less than 6 and 55 inches in height. They should be in a secured child passenger seat. And of course, anyone under the age of 18 must be in a seatbelt. Now, in this video that I'm going to show you about car restraints for children, I want you to look at the location for an infant. I'm talking about a newborn, someone that is under the age of 1. So take a look at the age of 1, all right?
More than 1,000 children 12 and under die in car crashes every year. And more than 100,000 are injured. But parents can reduce the risk to their kids if they put them in an appropriate car safety seat that's correctly installed in their vehicle. When a vehicle is moving at 30 miles per hour, so is everything inside it. If the vehicle crashes, unrestrained objects keep moving at their original speed until they strike the vehicle interior. This is why infant and child car seats are so important. They hold child passengers in place as the vehicle's front end does its job of crumpling and absorbing energy. This test demonstrates something parents don't even want to think about, an unprotected infant smashing into the instrument panel. Some parents think it's okay to ride with a child on their lap, but it's not. Crashes happen so fast and are so violent that you can't protect a child this way. Frontal airbags can be especially dangerous. In a crash, an airbag can hit a child or car seat with tremendous force. Even older children shouldn't sit in the front seat. The temptation to play with the radio can put them in harm's way. Children are always safer in the back seat. The basic types of car seats are rear-facing infant seats, forward-facing child seats, convertible seats that can be used either rear or forward-facing, and booster seats for children who've outgrown their forward-facing seat but aren't big enough for adult seat belts. Consider your child's age and size when picking out a car seat and whether it's compatible with your vehicle's seat and seat belts. Not all car seats will fit well into your vehicle. Proper installation has always been a struggle, but it is getting easier. Since September 2002, passenger vehicles are required to have special anchors, and most car seats have to be made with attachments that fit into them. This system is called latch. Lower attachments mate with anchors in the seat. Anchor points are usually marked. For forward-facing seats, top tethers get attached to anchors on the rear shelf or on vehicle seat backs. Car seats and vehicles without latch are still safe if you use the vehicle's belt system correctly. In order to do this in some vehicles, you may need to use a locking clip. Keep in mind, a car seat that fits easily into one vehicle may not fit very well, if at all, into another. Before you buy a car seat, try it in your vehicle to be sure it's compatible and can be tightly secured. Also, be sure to read the seat and vehicle owner's manuals to make installation go more smoothly. In some communities, you can check the installation at county checking stations, police or fire stations, car dealerships, or hospitals. If you're in a severe crash, inspect your child's car seat. If there's visible damage, you'll need to replace it. Remember, your child's safety is up to you. Always be sure he or she is properly buckled in without fail, every ride.
Okay, you probably didn't know, but they will not allow you to take an infant home from the hospital after you give birth to a child unless you have an approved child restraint seat and it's secured properly in a car. Okay? They just don't hand you the baby as you walk out the hospital door. They watch you put the baby in the car. I've often told this to people. You think you drive slow and perfect for your driving test? Most of you probably will. But I will tell you, there's one other time in your life that you will drive your absolute best. And that is when you're bringing an infant home from the hospital. You are going to be so nervous that you're going too fast and that every turn that you make, that the baby is going, the head's going to move. And remember, they don't have a muscle tone. So there is, that's why they've got that little, thing around the head to keep it in one place so the head can't, lean forward. So a infant seat is rear facing. All right. It's not forward facing. All right. And you want it to be directly in the middle of the vehicle. So between the driver and the passenger. Okay. In the middle, in the back, that's where you put an infant. Okay, because think about it. If the picture here, if you're going to get hit from the side, what we call a T-boned, okay, hit from the left or the right in the side of your car is going to crumple into that area. So the most protected area is the middle seat belt in the back. So if your parents have three kids, you always put your favorite child in the middle and the back. No, I'm only kidding. Then the next place is behind the passenger seat, okay, in the back. That way, if the baby needs attending, you can reach over and give a pacifier. You can see things a little bit better. The hardest position to have for an infant is directly behind the driver because you have no contact, meaning that even if you adjust your rearview mirror, you're not going to see very well, all right? So make sure it's latched, like it talked about. Make sure it's tight. If they do have their own little seat belt for their particular seat. And just drive safely because kids, their bodies move. And make sure they don't get out of the seat. That's very common, too, for kids when they figure out how to get in and get out. It can be a little bit traumatic to be going down the highway at 55 and you look in your rearview mirror and your three-year-old is standing on their car seat. It's like, how did he get out of that? Okay, not the best, not the best, but it does happen, so keep an eye. Now, the question comes, who doesn't have to be in a seatbelt? So if you're in a limousine, that's not required. School bus, for whatever reason, I don't know why. I've heard that they say the bus driver can't get everybody out in the event of a fire or a crash. But I think there's technology that would help prevent that. Of course, antique vehicles don't have them installed. Of course, motorcycles don't have them at all. And then any child that has any type of individual education plan with a note indicating that they don't need to be in a seatbelt because of a wheelchair or something like that, then they're going to be exempt from the requirement. Let's talk about helmet use. Now, some of you at some point in your life may want to drive a scooter, ride a motorcycle. There is no mandatory helmet law in New Hampshire for those older than 18. So make sure you write that down. It's strongly recommended. But if you're under the age of 18, because you are a minor, if you're a rider or a passenger, then a helmet is mandatory. And eye protection is used by everybody. Because you don't want, you know, debris or a fly, you know, getting in your eye, and you're not going to be able to see the road. You're trying to get whatever is in your eye out, and you're just not going to be able to focus. So eye protection is so important, and it is a must. I want to show you why helmets do make a difference. This was a video that someone made to kind of persuade people to wear a seatbelt. So you may want to do something like this if you know somebody that's been involved in a motor vehicle collision or whatever. It could be even be motocross. It doesn't have to be out on the road, but you know why helmets are important. So if you're on a back trail or something like that, you may, or even a snow machine. I'll take anything that's moving. Okay, why is it important to have a helmet on? So this individual did not have his helmet on, and he became a paraplegic.
Hey YouTube, it's Brian. Today's video I feel is very long overdue. Kind of wanted to talk about my motorcycle accident and more importantly, the helmet that I was wearing in the accident. In 2009, I was pulling out of my work parking lot. I was pulling onto a fairly busy road and there was a bunch of parallel parked cars on the side of the road. So when I pulled out, I turned right and I didn't see an oncoming car that was actually speeding. And right after I pulled out, the road started to curve. So what happened was I pulled out, saw this car coming, floored the bike trying to get out of the way, and got a little too close to the curve, the actual curb of the road. And there were a bunch of trees on the side of the road, and I happened to tip the bike over against the curb and slammed headfirst into a tree. I was doing about 35 miles an hour, not anything crazy fast, but this is what happened to my helmet after the accident. As you can see, I caved in the entire top of the helmet. As a result, this broke my spinal cord, and from the chest level down, I'm now paralyzed. So I know you're probably thinking, you know, why would I want to listen to a guy who's paralyzed talk about helmet safety? Well, there's quite a few reasons. First being that I have zero brain injury. That was the biggest thing. My injury is completely physical, which has allowed me to do a lot of things. Obviously, I can still work. I co-manage a group of over 30 people. I can actually still take care of myself. I can take care of my bathroom routine. I can get myself dressed. I am fully independent. I'm married. I have a beautiful wife. I have a great job. I have, you know, a sports car. I like to autocross my car, which is a form of racing, and I do that quite a bit. I still work on cars. That's something I've always really loved to do. So there's a lot of things in my life that I don't think I would have been able to do had I had a brain injury. As you can see, I wouldn't have even had that chance had I slammed headfirst into a tree. I would have been completely dead. There was no way that I would be sitting here talking to you today. I actually went through rehab with a guy who had a similar accident. He was going through an intersection on his bike. A car was coming through, ran a red light. He slammed into that car, flipped off his bike, and he didn't have a helmet on, and he hit his head real hard on the concrete. He was not the same guy that he was before. He it basically knocked him back to third grade. When he was in rehab, he was tripping over himself. He was rambling. You know, he would just start talking, you know, gibberish. He just wasn't present. He wasn't himself. And that is one thing, the biggest thing, aside from my life, that this helmet has saved is my brain and my personality. When it comes to brain injuries, it can vary as far as what your symptoms are. It's all about where your brain was injured. So there's people who have lost complete memory. They actually have to write things down throughout the day to keep track of what they've done. If they went to the bathroom, you know, if they just anything throughout the day, they're actually writing it down. Their speech can be impaired. All these things are preventable from wearing a helmet. There's a lot of people who were married and they ended up getting divorced as a result of their brain injury because, you know, they might be very hard to take care of. Or the other thing is, since their personality is so much different, there's women that have said, you know, this isn't the same man that I married. That is one thing that I feel like I still have. I still have my personality. I'm still the same person. I can still joke. I can still do everything, you know, mentally that I could do before my accident. Obviously, there are some restrictions from a wheelchair, but I've overcome quite a bit of stuff. I even, believe it or not, I even modified my motorcycle to ride post-injury. It had little legs that folded down and a electric shifter. So what I would do is I'd push a button, the legs would fold up out of the way, and I would ride again. So that was one thing right after my injury that really kind of kept my mind out of the dark side. Obviously, I had a couple times where I thought about committing suicide. I didn't think that I could live my life from a wheelchair, or at least not have a quality, you know, life. I've found that that's complete bullshit. I have a great life. You know, like I said, I've got a great wife. I still hang out with friends. I still go on vacation. I still go swimming. I still do pretty much everything that I used to do. I just do it a little bit differently. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. I know people that ride motorcycles are extremely hard-headed. I was one of them. My accident, I thought, you know, if I ever got in an accident that I would break a leg or I would break my arm. I never imagined that I would smash into a tree and be paralyzed. But then again, if I hadn't been wearing the helmet, I would be dead. That would have been end of story for me. And I don't have the brain injury, like I said. So I can still do everything that I did before, just a little bit differently. Another thing I've still been able to do is watch my niece and nephew grow up. Just to see them from a little baby and, you know, the toddlers they are right now. To watch a child grow is just an amazing thing. I think, you know, if I was already a father, there's no way in hell I'd be on a motorcycle myself. But think about that. I mean, if you got killed, who's going to take care of your kids? And do you really want them growing up without a father, or growing up with a father with a brain injury who can't take care of them? I think that is the biggest reason. If you are going to choose to get on a bike, you need to get a helmet and you need to wear it. Don't have it strapped to the side of the bike as you're going down the highway. That's not going to help because anything can happen. That's one thing I've figured out. I took an advanced riding course 2 weeks before my injury. I mean, I was a safe rider. I did everything I thought I should. I wore the full gear, and stuff happens. I mean, it's just how it works, especially these days with everybody on their cell phones constantly. Accidents are everywhere around the corner, and if you're on a motorcycle, you don't have a cage around you. You're not in a car. You don't have an airbag. You're pretty much exposed to anything and everything on the road. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. If you have any questions, write in the comments below, and I'll talk to you soon. Thanks a lot.
I thought that was probably the best video that I've come across dealing with helmet use and why it's so important. You could just see by the x-ray and the pictures of him in the hospital how violent, even though he had a helmet on, he was in bad shape. I mean, to think that he's got to live the rest of his life in a wheelchair, but his positive attitude is what's carrying him through. And he also mentioned people that didn't have that kind of positive attitude and how it changed their personality. So helmet use is so important if you are a rider or a passenger on a motorcycle. I can't stress enough, don't think because you're going at low speeds. And notice he said he was only going around 30, 35 miles per hour. So he wasn't going, 110 on 95 and lost control of his bike. He was just pulling out of a parking lot and he didn't see a vehicle or the vehicle didn't see him. And by the way, I think she's still on. It was Sabrina that was driving tonight at 4 o'clock, and we had a motorcycle come out in front of us. It was kind of hidden off to the right behind a parked car that pulled out. It was kind of a risky type of a turn. I mean, if we were up an extra 50, 75 feet, who knows what might have happened. But it was relatively close. It was closer than probably it should have been, only because of the motorcyclist taking the risk of pulling out in front of a vehicle. But these things do happen. So I just want to make you understand that don't take anything for granted. And the other thing that really gets me is when I see a motorcycle rider with his helmet attached to the back of his vehicle. It's like you've got one. Why not use it? But there are people out there that are doing that. So that was, let's see, I think I've got. So there's the definition of ramping, which I already gave you. And we already talked about the three different types of collisions. I think that's it. The manual does go over some of the facts. Let me go through these real quick. So you can include this in your assignment, your project. Seatbelt use, the chances of survival twice as good when you're not belted. If you use the shoulder harness as well as the seatbelt, then it's 3 to 4 times more effective. They keep you from moving around. We talked about how airbags come out, and if your body's moving left to right, it's not going to be of a benefit to you. You want it to hit your body squarely. They keep you in a good driving posture, and with a good driving posture, you're going to be more alert. You're going to make better turns. They keep you from being thrown from the vehicle. We saw a video tonight of someone leaving the car. I don't think they made it. Chance of survival, much better if you stay within the protection of your car. And it does slow down your body with an airbag when you're in your seatbelt. Okay, let's go to what the homework is. So write this down. Your homework, your project, okay, is to do a poster. A poster needs to have two facts about seatbelts or helmets or airbags. So two facts. Some of the things we talked about, you can Google seatbelt usage. We talked about New Hampshire, how many people are injured or killed. We talked about primary, secondary offenses. It could be something like that. I just pulled one from my last class. Here is a seatbelt poster from somebody. This is what I'm looking for. See the two facts at the bottom? In 2016, seatbelts saved almost 15,000 lives. That's what we talked about tonight. 3/4 of the people ejected from cars die from their injuries. And then he just kind of came up with some cars, a body outside. I don't know if he did this on his own or if he found a picture, but that's all I care about. So I want you to do some type of a poster. Make it colorful. You have to have graphics, but I want two facts. If you don't want to do that, if you want to do a radio ad where you speak into your phone, and I'd first write out a script, communicate things that you want to convey about why it's important to be in your seatbelt why it's important to have your helmet on or to buy a car that is equipped with multiple airbags and how airbags save lives. You can do a radio type of ad, so just speak into the memo. Now, all these things have to be sent to me, all right, through text message or email, but these need to be sent to me. So posters due tomorrow. Radio ad is due tomorrow. Now, if you choose to do the video ad, okay, if you choose to do a video, oh, by the way, the radio ad has to be at least 30 seconds long. Same thing with the video. The video needs to be at least a minute long, and it's got to have two facts about seatbelts. Now, this first video I'm going to show you from a student was didn't include two facts, but they did such a good job with the script and the music, I gave them an A+. So you do get extra credit on your final if you do a video. But here's one of my favorite videos.
All right, Violet, time for school. Yeah, what song?
You know what.
Da 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 da. It's the one and only Deco Double G.
Snoop Dogg. Snoop
Dogg. Da 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 da. You know I'm hopping with the D-R-E.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know the West Coast is back for all you suckers.
What?
Suckers. So put something in there.
Place it.
Put it in
there.
Yeah. Suck, no.
Top dog, bite them all. Yeah, I'm burning it up. DPGC, you should be talking.
So I thought he did a fantastic job with the script and the music and got his sister involved. So if you do something like that, I will give you extra credit on your final. And here's one more from earlier in pandemic. This is someone that you may know in school right now.
I know. I'm moving.
You're always late.
I'm sorry. You're just not going to wear your seatbelt?
I don't need to wear a seatbelt. I'm literally a good...
Just as many people die in car accidents because they're not wearing seatbelts.
We literally have to get to school. We're late. You know I'm a good driver. Stop acting so smart.
Bruh, do you hear that? Their whole point is to prevent drivers from being ejected from the vehicles during car crashes. You're 30 times more likely to be ejected from a vehicle during a crash if you're not wearing your seatbelt.
So pretty simple. You know, they mentioned some facts. You know, there was some type of a back and forth of why it was important and not. So something like that, I think, goes a long way. So get creative, get some comedy into it. I always like to laugh, but I know videos take some time to put together, so I'm not going to have this due tomorrow. The poster will be due tomorrow. The radio ad will be due tomorrow. So if you want to do one of those two, it does have to be sent to me tomorrow before class. But the video, I'll give you extra time to complete that. The other thing that I need you to do is to read chapter 6 and 7 in Responsible Driving. We're going to talk about communication. We're going to talk about decision making, and we're going to talk about turns tomorrow. So we're going to kind of get into behind the wheel information. So we're off and running with the state manual and the textbook for tomorrow. So that is it for tonight. So, I still have a 3:00. Is there anybody that wants to drive tomorrow at 3:00? Okay, so text me if you can drive at 3:00. I'm looking for a 3:00 or a 1:00. I think I could probably do 1:00 too. So please just text me and let me know if you can drive at those times. And we'll see you tomorrow at 7:30. Have a good night.